we're doing is showing the town where it's going to be on the wall.
Oh, okay. Right. We can do that.
Okay. Do you want to... You,
why not?
Sure. And when we get to it, I'm going to start off with...
Oh, okay.
You're on camera now, though.
Okay.
Peter, you're all set.
Okay, great. Well, we have a quorum. Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming. This is the meeting of the Georgetown Community Preservation Commission. It is Tuesday, April 11th, 2017 at 7:30 p.m. And we have a quorum here of the Community Preservation Committee. So we'll start the meeting in session. This evening's, first of all, my name's Peter Burns. I'm the vice chair of the Community Preservation Committee, and I'm here facilitating the meeting on behalf of our chair, Harry Locatelia, who could not be here today. Also, we have with us Gary Fowler from the representing the Board of Selectmen, James Demento from the Park and Rec Commission, Rachel Bancroft to my left from the Conservation Commission, and Paul Nelson from the Affordable Housing Trust. So we're going to get started. The purpose of the meeting tonight, this is our annual public information meeting. And so every year after the Community Preservation Committee has gone through, we've reviewed proposals that have come in for requests for funding. We've made some, we've reviewed those proposals, and now we're making recommendations with the following projects that we're going to present to you tonight. And so these projects will be reviewed by the Board of Selectmen, and then they'll appear on the warrant at the annual town meeting on May 1st. So the whole point of the project of the meeting tonight is to give folks an idea of how we're recommending that the Community Preservation Act funds be spent. James Davenport from the Historical Commission is now joining us too. Hello, James.
Hi.
So I'm going to get started with just a quick background, a little bit about the Community Preservation Act and how it relates to us in Georgetown. Give a summary of the recommendations for funding that we have for 2017, and then I'm going to hand it over to the various experts in the room here to run us through the individual proposals that we are recommending. So first of all, the Community Preservation Act was enacted by the Commonwealth of Massachusetts in 2000. The point of the Community Preservation Act is to allow communities to create a local community preservation fund for open space protection, historical preservation, affordable housing, and outdoor recreation. The funds are raised locally via a property tax surcharge, and the state provides an additional funding source via the Community Preservation Trust Fund. About half of the towns in Massachusetts have now adopted the Community Preservation Act in their town. In Georgetown, we adopted the CPA back in 2001. We voted it that in at town meeting, and we also voted to have a 3% surcharge on the residential property tax. You can have anywhere, it starts at 1% and all the way up to 3% is the maximum amount, so that's what we've chosen. So the first $100,000 of value is waived. And so the revenue comes in on the surcharge of everything over $100,000 in value on each residential property. Then the Community Preservation Trust Fund kicks in with several rounds of funding to give the town some additional funding for the purposes of the community preservation. And so we have established a Community Preservation Committee to advise the selectmen and the public on the recommendations for use of the funds. And so each one of us represents a different board within the town that has an interest in these core responsibilities under the Community Preservation Act. There's a 10% reserve. So based on all the revenues that we get either from tax surcharges or from the Commonwealth, we must appropriate or reserve at least 10% of those for each of the three core CPA categories. And those core categories are community housing, so they can be used for the creation, renovation, or establishing Americans with Disabilities Act access to certain housing units. It is for 10% reserve for historical preservation, so that's the restoration, acquisition, and access for open space, for historic preservation, historic properties. And open space preservation and protection and active recreational land use needs. And so we've gone through and we've done that this year. We've set aside $52,000 for each one of those three core categories, which is in excess of 10% of our total revenues that are available for expenditure this year. So once the reservations are made, the voters must decide whether to approve or reject the projects that the local Community Preservation Committee has recommended for the year. So we're going to be running through the projects, and so these are our recommendations for the use of the funds for the set-asides for each of the three core categories. Also, there's an administrative fund that we've set aside $21,000 for that's a normal thing that we usually do too. And then the rest is going to be on the warrant for the May 1, 2017 town hall, town meeting. So here's a summary of how we have recommended that the funds be expended. So it comes to about $525,000 for this year. So first of all, there's a housing authority swing gate for $8,000. The Affordable Housing Trust block grant for $60,000. Union Cemetery gravestone restoration is $20,000. Schoolhouse number 2 restoration is $20,000. Brocklebank Museum exterior painting, $12,000. Bond costs, and I'll explain that a little bit more later, $400,000 toward the payment of bonds. And then Camp Denison bathroom rehabilitation is $5,000. And we also had, we had under two previously approved warrants, we had $40,000 made available to fix the parking lot and do some other things at the West Street Fields. There was $11,000 some odd dollars that was left over from that that wasn't expended. And so this, in this warrant, we're also asking the town to repurpose or redesignate those funds for use in fixing some of the West Street Fields, the rehabilitation on the soccer fields. So as far as the bond allocation and payment go, in 2013, the town approved bonding from CPA funds to pay for the high school fields rehabilitation. That was Article 27I, and for the conservation restriction for the Wheeler Brook Farm. And so to make these payments on the bond acquisition costs and associated debt service, the town voters will be asked to approve the necessary funding through an annual appropriation made at the same time that we're going to be making the recommendations for 10% for the three core funding focuses of the act, which is the open space, the historical preservation, and affordable housing. So this year, I think I already talked about this one. I'm going up or down. Here we go. Okay, so this year in the CPC and public meetings, we reviewed the suggested projects that were submitted, and these are the ones that we're going to go with, and these are follow that summary that I gave. So we'll start off with the community housing category project. Paul, would you like to present
yes,
that?
Yes, I'd like to start with setting up a little context for affordable housing per se. Basically, I did a little research and just went into Googling the Boston Globe on affordable housing, and I came up with some interesting facts. Turns out the Urban Institute study shows that there's no county in the U.S. that has an adequate affordable housing in the country, in the whole country. They don't have enough affordable housing. In Essex County, which is us, we essentially have 44 affordable units for every 100 families of extremely low income. So in other words, if you don't have any money, you don't have any place to live in Essex County, because there's no facility. The homelessness and hunger is increasing among college students. The North Shore Community College, which is also in Essex County, 32% are hungry and 19% are homeless. The third thing is moving families from the low-income areas to successful communities, like if we have a unit here and we can actually then bring somebody from, say, the inner city out here, they tend to succeed out here where they wouldn't if they stayed. And it's environmental. I mean, if you look around and you see success, it's going to be pervasive. If you see failure, that's the norm, and so it's expected. So anyway, that's just a context for looking at it. So,
excellent, great. So you want to get,
yep,
first thank one. You for that.
So essentially, we're asking for $60,000 this year, and that's a block grant, which allows us to do multiple things with it, and I will get into that, the multiplicity of things that we can actually do. The mission is basically to create affordable housing, and it comes in various forms. Basically, you can have ownership, you can have rental, and we can help in a number of different ways. We could do it, which we haven't yet, but we're looking at doing is a down payment assistance program. We currently have a rental assistance program that's been very successful. And essentially, we have the ability to react to any kind of a situation if it arises to actually afford to purchase affordable housing. We have right now the rental assistance program. We're trying to establish a monitoring agent capability. Anytime you have affordable housing, somebody's got to watch the store. Somebody's got to make sure that everything's being done correctly. And most of us are not trained in this to the depth that needs to be. And so we have to purchase these services. Actually, it wasn't quite done. That's close enough, though. And finally, again, what we're really trying to do is, on the fly, is look for ways that we can actually purchase land or work with somebody else to actually create affordable housing. Okay. And in 2016, basically, with Attorney Leaf and the planning board, Attorney Leaf development people, we have two new affordable houses. This is the first affordable housing units have been put on our affordable housing list since 2009, so it's about time. And they're both three-bedroom houses. One is brand new, the other one is refurbished, and currently there is actually somebody living in the rental unit. The purchase unit, I'm not sure. I drive by there, but I don't see any cars, so I'm not sure. And that was handled totally by the developer, so we weren't too involved in it. Both these units now are on the state subsidized housing inventory. We got them on about a month ago, so that gives us one more count, or two more counts. Slide didn't come out too well. That's all right. The rental, if you look at what we're supposed to be doing, if you look at the housing production plan, which I'll talk about a little bit later, it says that what you need more than anything else is rentals. Housing to purchase, a lot of people that are low income, very low income, they don't have the ability to maintain a house. And so a rental property fits a lot nicer into what they can do, what they can handle. Let's see. And we want to maintain the status of the current affordable units. We're actually right now working with, there's a unit, a condo that's being resold. There's also a elderly unit that's being resold. And it's amazing. A lot of people don't know, especially elderly people, they don't understand the significance of having an affordable property. They just think you sell it, and you really don't. It has a special deed rider on it that has to be transferred. And so it gets interesting, and this one has been pretty interesting. We're looking at an opportunity at 34 East Main, Dunbar Tavern. That's been around for quite a while. It has some issues, but on the other hand, it has the best location in town. It's walking distance to all the downtown areas. There's a park and ride right across the street. There is actually enough space there to do two cars for every unit. They're looking at putting eight units in there, two of which would be affordable. Okay. And this is our guide, if you will. This is the housing production plan. This one was put in place in 2011. They're good for 5 years, and we are in a process right now of getting that updated. So unfortunately, all the data that I've got, for the most part, comes from this document here. But in Georgetown, things don't change that quickly. So it's not like we had 50 units that went in or anything like that. Actually, we did. We had like 30. And the production plan basically it tries to analyze what your demographics look like. And then based on those demographics, it says, here's the kind of thing you should be doing. In our situation, if you look at Georgetown, it's a bedroom community. And basically, mostly you have large single-family homes. And that's not the kind of unit that qualifies as affordable in anybody's book. So right now, actually in 2011, there were 75 families who were living at or below the poverty level. And the demand that was established back in 2011, my guess it'll be reinforced when we get our new one out this year, is that the rental will still be one of the largest necessities. And it's a tough one to drive. And the demand for starter homes. And again, when you're building McMansions, these are not starter homes. But there's no incentive for a developer to take an acre of land and put a starter home on it. None. And then there's a demand for elderly to have ability to age in place. And that's really, there's two ways to look at that. We only have a set number of elderly units, and that doesn't look like it's expanding very fast. So that's one way you age in place. The other would be just to stay in your home. And we don't have a good facility for dealing with things like that. We tried to do accessory apartments a couple of years ago, and that went over like a lead balloon. But that would have been one way where people could have earned some money off rooms they weren't using, therefore could afford to stay in their house. But that didn't work so well. So again, this is from the 2011 housing production plan, and it gives you some demographic issues there. The affordable, it's changed just by a couple of units. So the number of family rental units is 10. Senior disabled is 126. That's mostly Trestle Way. And then Longview, there's 38 units there that are affordable out of 186. So that's not bad. Ownership, there's five homes that are actually affordable. Senior disabled, there's six. So let's see. The idea behind the housing production plan, it's like if you want to put a strategy together, that's what it's all about. And then what we want to do is then put together the mechanisms that will actually allow you to execute to the housing production plan to satisfy what its goals are. And to do that, the housing Affordable Housing Trust is essentially like a bank. It has all the fiduciary capabilities of a bank, pretty much. It allows us to do things like we get a block grant. And people say, why are you going to give anybody a block grant? That's money that's not designated for anything in particular. And you could just blow it. But basically, we don't. And the other thing it lets us do is, like, Trestle Way has needed things in between the cycles of the CPC, which are yearly. Like right now, there's $15,000 that we just sent a voucher for last week for Trestle Way's ramp. They had put together a plan that it called for $15,000. When they actually did the real engineering drawings, it turned out to be a little bit more. And so we had to put in $15,000. We didn't have to, but we put in $15,000 because that's what we're all about. Let's see. And whoop, nope, not quite done yet. The other thing we're doing, we fund a rental assistance program that has had generally eight families or households. Now it's down to five. One of the things we want to do this coming year is reinvigorate that plan. And we'll do that by getting out all the literature to the various churches and groups like that. And then there's a line item to fund the local administration for the trust. That didn't work too well. Unfortunately, we went through a number of planners, and every time a planner comes in, they don't know diddly squat about affordable housing. And so we go back to square one. So right now, basically, I'm doing it. I got elected secretary at our last meeting. So now I have a title. I don't think there's a salary with it, though.
No one calls you diddly, though, right?
No diddly, yeah. Don't diddly spot, yeah. And so the other thing we try to do, and we've tried this, and it almost worked one time, to work with housing partners, people that actually do affordable housing as a mission. And we were going to use the lot over on Moulton Street. And the problem is that it has a pollution. It was the site of an electrical switch manufacturer, and they took all of their tetrachloride and they just dumped it in the ground. And so that plume is now heading towards one of the ponds. So, but anyway, they can't let us have that because they can't. If they give it to us and something happens, they still own all the responsibility for the problems. So they're not going to give it to us. Let's see, in 2017, the 40B seems to be coming alive decently at the Dunbar Tavern. We were trying to make this happen, and things were really going very, very slow. And there's a group called LDS, and they're actually the ones that are doing a housing production plan. they found out about Dunbar Tavern. It turns out that they actually do 40B services too. So they're picking up the ball and helping us run with it. Actually, they're pretty much doing it by themselves. And they're pretty good at it. What we need to do though is come up with something that's amenable to all sides, because Dunbar Tavern is an interesting situation where it's not a cheap build. And so there's going to have to be some extra money in the system from someplace, and that hasn't been figured out yet. We want to continue the WRAP program and look at doing a down payment assistance program. That would be first time home buyers. Again, the major problem there is, do you want to give a down payment assistance program for a McMansion? No, don't want to do that. So we don't have a lot of stock. We don't have a lot of stock that would fit for a new family just starting out. Maybe just a couple, maybe three, you know, with one child or two children. So the other thing we're doing is we've looked at doing land acquisition. That hasn't gone over really well. We almost got a piece of land on Jewett Street, but it just kind of like fell through. We're also working with Habitat. They are interested in actually this property that kind of like just fell through. And Harborlight. Harborlight was the one that was going to do Moulton Street, and they were going to put in 24 units down there, and it would be all rental and it would be a live-in. It was great, and it just fell apart because of the pollution. And then we want to actually extend our infrastructure to be able to do the kind of things that we really need to do. Since we don't have an agent, what we found is that we've actually developed relationships with a lot of groups that do that for a fee, which is almost better in the sense that it's service on demand as opposed to somebody just sitting there even when nothing's happening. So I think that's going to be working out pretty well. LDS is good at a lot of different things, including monitoring agent works and things like that. So I think that'll work out well. This is the rental at 32 Lisa Lane. This is renting for like $1,300 a month, which is cheaper than a two-bedroom condo at Longview, market rate. And this is the purchased house. This is 30 Lisa Lane. They're right next to each other. I'm not sure there's anybody living in it or not. I really don't know.
There is?
Okay. Yep. Okay, that's right. You live out there, yeah. And that's that was pretty much all handled by the developer, so we didn't get involved. But it actually goes on our subsidized housing inventory, so we get credit for it.
Great.
So, any questions or from the huge audience? No.
Okay. Yeah. Keep in mind, this is a public meeting, so we're here for you, for your information. So, if you have any questions, please, we're interested in what you. Any questions or any thoughts you might have. I'm going to back up a little bit because I forgot one thing that was under the community housing category project. Thank you, Paul, for that presentation. I appreciate that. That was good. So there was another project under the community housing group, which is the Swing Gate. Does anyone care to present this one, or do you want me to just run through it real quick?
Yeah, just emergency access Swing Gate for the Trussell Way area.
Right.
And it was requested by Trussell Way and I know the chief of police and the fire department also wrote a letter and recommendation. So,
right.
It's just an emergency access to a Trussell Way, and I think it also has something to do with the rails, the railroad bed as well. But we discussed going with a chain link fence and different options, but it seemed like the gate was what everybody wanted, so it will be there for a long time, and we felt it was the safest option. So we, as a group, recommended it.
Right. Okay. Any questions on the gate?
No questions on the gate, but I just want to give some accolades to Paul for all the hard work that you've done on the Affordable Housing Trust. I had the privilege of being on that committee with you for years, and you're still working your butt off.
I enjoy
it. It is hard work.
It's rewarding too.
It is rewarding, but it's hard to put these deals in place. There's no simple properties out there to acquire, to renovate and stuff. It makes it very, very challenging. This guy's working his butt off. Good job.
Thank you.
Very resourceful, thinking outside the box, for sure.
I also think he's laying the groundwork for future generations. I think people are going to have to be doing this while you're doing it now, but in 10, 15 years. And
I won't be here?
Well, you might be here. If you want to be doing it 15 years, but I'm saying it shows the work and the mythology that takes to get something done. You have to, the town only has so much land and so much property and zoning regulations, and you got to find what fits for the time period. Like you said, you're looking at the different methods of trying to get rental units in with the zoning bylaws, and it takes a lot of work.
And everything is really event-driven.
Yes.
Something shows up as an opportunity. If you don't jump on it, it's gone.
Yes.
So I just heard that you've just volunteered for another 15 years of service.
Yeah, I was trying to give him an out, and I guess he didn't take it, did he?
Well, speaking on a positive note of affecting generations, a family has recently moved into 32 Lisa Lane. So they're riding their bikes in a nice, quiet neighborhood, and they've been there for a couple of weeks now. So that family will be there. And, talking about a positive influence on a generational, depending on how long that family stays there, but the family will certainly remember living there. So.
Yeah.
Okay, very good. So we're going to move on to the historical preservation category projects. And the first one is the Union Cemetery Gravestone Restoration.
Sure.
This is the Gravestone Monument Restoration Phase 2. Mr. Trapani, you're going to walk us through this one?
Yeah, so first of all, James, thank you for putting these slides together. So the request was restore about 75 gravestones that are broken over there. There's another 100 that are leaning, but this was literally to restore and repair about 75 old gravestones that go back from the late 1700s in Georgetown. Phase one of the project has been completed. It was done a few years ago with the support of your committee here, and we appreciate that. I know that you guys have are supporting it again this year for us to move to the second phase. And with the approval of the funds that you guys are recommending, we'll be able to continue doing that, probably do about half of what the next initial phase that we had planned on doing it, and just separate that over a period of 2 years if we're lucky enough to get the funding again next year for it. But it's good. We're happy. We're excited. There's, cemetery needs work. It's a landmark in town, and your support will really help bring that and restore that back to hopefully where it was at one point.
Mm-hmm.
Good. Yeah. James, anything that you've got?
No, I mean, I've been on the Georgetown Historical Commission, which, just for everyone to know, is a different entity than the wonderful Georgetown Historical Society. It is a commission. It runs typically on 2-year terms, I believe, and since 2006, I've really seen a full cycle, a full generational cycle of a project, from research, the due diligence of the project, to the town approval of the project, and then the town enjoyment of that project. For example, the Harry Murch Park, there's the Merchant Marine flagpole. So that project was recommended several years ago, and now I know that there's, I think we've enjoyed several Veterans Day events at that park, and other events at that park as well. But it's just an example of, the project was funded, and now everyone's enjoying all the flags. There's 6 flags. The Peabody Library has restored a new painting, or have restored an old painting, and it's hanging up in the library. So some of our assets are both tangible and intangible for the town to enjoy. One of the larger assets of Georgetown is the Union Cemetery, and like Phil had mentioned, the original request was 75 with $20,000, which I think you can go to the next slide. With $20,000, we'll be able to do half of this year's recommendation, which is going to allude to a phase three. If you could just go back to that last slide. Some of the items that have already been completed at the Union Cemetery was the placement of the iron fence. We've done a lot of research on these gravestones. They've been mapped, they've been plotted, they've been assembled in a document so that we have some organization of what needs to be fixed, what marking is on each plot. We've done a lot of research on some of the individuals there. I know the Boy Scouts have been involved in the Union Cemetery. We've erected a flag and a flag pole. Some of the stones have been buried through years of neglect and fallen trees and leaves and all sorts of evasive species that have just at one point had taken over the Union Cemetery. So this is kind of all in line of a master plan that was established by the Georgetown Historical Commission members of the Historical Society, and I certainly don't want to admit anyone from the town, but there were also many other town members that were involved in that master plan. That master plan can either be found, if you can either Google it or you can find it on the town's website. But it is a full document of a brief history of the town, a brief history of the Union Cemetery, the gravestones, and the partnership that the Georgetown Historical Commission plans on using, which is Fannin Lehner of Concord, Massachusetts. I think they're on the next slide. Yes, Fannin Lehner. They've been in existence for many, many years. I won't go into this slide, but for those of you at home, you can certainly just quickly brief on their expertise. They are experts on restoring gravestones. You can go to the next slide, Chairman. So there are actually over 334 gravestones in the Union Cemetery. I say approximately. That's kind of what we've mapped out. And as Phil said, they go back to the early 1700s. And with this town approval, we'll be approving $20,000. It will be half of what we wanted to get, but with the CPC's recommendation and due diligence, I think that's appropriate for this year. Again, it is in continuation of 2009. All work will be in compliance with Mass Historic regulations and standards. And just so you know, everything will be documented. There'll be photographs before and after. And there'll be a report on each stone that needs to get fixed. And with kind of the Fannin Lehner will do the analysis. Whatever we can get done in this phase, or in what we can't get done, we'll just kind of conclude in an upcoming phase at a later date. That's it.
Yep. Awesome. Good.
Why did it come Union? Does that Union Cemetery? Does that allude anything to the Civil War? Or?
Well, this no. I would. I mean, it would have to be. It precluded the Civil War.
Yeah,
and the Civil War was in the 1800s. The cemetery was set aside, I believe, in 1732. I think that was the title of the cemetery. Its original title. So that was all of 130 years before the Civil War. So
the name was changed after the Civil War.
So okay.
To Union Cemetery.
Okay. So it wasn't the original name, but it's been there. Those that rest there have the right to have their sacred rights kind of cleaned up and restored and preserved. So it's an asset that everyone drives by every day. You probably don't think about what's inside that cemetery, but it certainly looks a lot better, and we hope to continue and improve the site. So,
very good. Okay. Any questions or comments?
Make one comment. It's interesting. I just recently heard the difference between a cemetery and burying or burial grounds. and it's that a cemetery has roads through it. With burying grounds, I guess, don't. I never was aware of that.
Okay, well, let's stick with the historical category, and we'll go to the next project, which is the restoration of schoolhouse number 2.
So I'll just start this off here and say a couple things. So the request was for $49,000, I believe it was, for the all of the repairs that need to restore the schoolhouse. So everything from the interior and the exterior. The schoolhouse, as you may know in town, has been used in conjunction for a number of things with the schools, primarily for education, historical education. So the Georgetown Historic Society spends a lot of time and effort working with the schools to bring in kids during the year and show them what it was like to learn in a single room schoolhouse. The schoolhouse was built in the early 1800s and has gone through a number of different repairs over the years, but it's in really rough shape. It's in rough shape for a few reasons. There's no defined budget to support it. There is no maintenance budget on the schoolhouse, which is a shame, but over the years we just haven't had budget. The Georgetown Historic Commission has a budget of $1,000, and that was doubled last year or the year before from $500. So it's unfortunate that we have this crazy cycle where we'll restore and just let it go and go and go because we don't have the funds to properly maintain it until it gets to a point where it's restorable now, and that's where, you know, CPC monies can actually be applied to it. There's a couple things that we've got some challenges ahead of us. I know the request was for $49,000 for the entire restoration. The roof itself, which is the biggest issue with it, you really don't want to do any renovations to the interior until you fix the exterior. $20,000 may not get us to anything this year. It may or may not, but most of the bids came in between $24,000 and $28,000 just for the roof itself. So we're going to do what we can with that $20,000 to see if we can get it some work done on the roof this year. It'll be very difficult for us to get the roof repaired with $20,000. And if it doesn't, then there's two things that will happen. One, we're probably going to have to put a tarp on it for a year, which kind of stinks. And then the second is to that fund that is approved this year, it may just sit in an account until next year when we ask for another request to complete at least the roof. Then, but I just want to give you for forewarning. I don't know if $20,000 is going to actually do anything because we do not want to touch the interior until the exterior is done on that building. But we're appreciative of the fact that you guys are considering and have considered. As the slide shows, it's the interior is in rough shape, but that's okay. I mean, it's not a cause of safety or any further deterioration of the building itself. Everything needs to be scraped down and repainted in the schoolhouse itself. But the roof, the fascia boards, there's a rot all over. There's some worm that's causing all sorts of problems, if not termites, in there. But we've got to do a lot of work to. We basically have to restore the entire thing, except for we do not have to replace any of the clapboards. Those seem to be in pretty good condition. Just all the fascia, the trim, the roof, interior painting, exterior painting, and the sign seem to be the biggest issues.
The size of the building?
I would think it's 16 by 18 or something like that. It's not huge. It's about about double the size of this space right here. Yeah, maybe a little bit bigger than 16 by 18. But it's cedar shingles on the roof.
I'm aware of it. I did a...
You would know it better than I did.
Well, I milled shingles for a building over in Ipswich.
Put a bid in.
And
Yeah, now my understanding too, there's different qualities of cedar shingles as well. And
well, the ones we did were 2-foot shingles. That's why I had to mill them, because it's difficult to find them.
Yeah.
I don't know the age of that one. This was a 1700 building, and so we wanted like 8-inch of shingle showing. So they get three courses. You got to go with a 2-foot shingle. So,
what he said.
It ain't cheap. Right. Okay. I got another slide here. You want to talk about this a little bit more? Or?
Yeah. So our first estimate came in at $42,000. Our second one came in at $48,000, and there's a third one somewhere in the middle of there. So, and all of the estimates came, pretty well over $20,000 just for the roof itself. We'll if we can get it done for 20 grand, we will do it. It needs to be done, and it needs to be done quickly.
Yeah, I mean, if I remember the conversation when we had our vote, the committee, I think we saw this one as sort of hitting square in the middle of the historical preservation, and we know that it's an important building, but I think we wanted to make sure that we were, giving credit to a lot of other projects that sort of fell in the mix too. So just trying to put something toward it, knowing that maybe it wouldn't do everything, but it might be a start. So,
well, I just want to make sure I set your expectations. If you don't see any work down there this year, it's because we just weren't able to get step one done, and that's the roof before anything else. But if you hopefully you guys are comfortable with us, retaining those funds if approved, and waiting, and if we need to come back and at least ask for the additional funds to support that part of the project, if not the rest of the project for next year.
Okay. Anything else?
No. We continue to thank you for the support. I actually am finishing up a project right now, which shows you from 2013 till this year of all the CPC funds that have supported historic, and it's a ton. And I don't think the public understands every year. We just, you give it dribs right. and drabs. Well, in some years you give some significant funds as well, but it is it's a lot of capital that you guys have provided the historic commission to preserve history in town.
Can you imagine?
So we appreciate that.
And I kind of look at the same thing with the Park and Rec. Can you imagine if it wasn't there over the last so many years, where it would be historically and recreationally?
I will tell you, it's you think as a taxpayer that you get this 3% surcharge on it. You would either put it in the general fund and fight for it, and trying to increase taxes that way to do stuff, but you'd be always fighting for it, and there's always other priorities, because history, to a lot of people, history isn't necessarily a priority when and it's tomorrow, it's yesterday's work. We need to fund today's problems, right? So your funding mechanisms and what you guys are doing here, I don't think people in town really recognize the significant. Maybe they do, maybe they don't, but it's phenomenal.
It's an amazing opportunity to be able to fund these things, like you say, that wouldn't normally have a line item in the budget. We're funding it with real money. It's not like we're waiting for the state to give us something in it, after the fact. I mean, this is revenues that we've already acquired.
For a number of years early, because we were in 3%, we got a dollar.
Matching
dollars. Now it's gone down over the years, and there's an article in today's paper about that. But for many years, we're getting a dollar for dollar, which was a great value for the people who had the foresight to go full in 3%.
What's the expected match this year for the CPC?
For 2017?
2017, yeah, next year, I guess. Next year.
I don't know what
next year's not going to be good, because a lot of the cities are jumping in now. That was the focus of the article, that the first round matching funds was, they said, 20% this year, and it's going to go down to 15% next year. So there's going to be a point, but there's some legislation in to require when you go to register your car, so to revitalize the CPA, so the first round of funds are 50%. So it would bring up your matching funds to a minimum of 50. And I think that's, they think that's going to have a lot of impact. I do know that a lot of people are jumping in. Amesbury's jumping in with the Rails Trail, Newburyport. A lot of people are looking at these funds for development of revitalization of cities with rails, trails, and recreational paths, and of course we're waiting for ours as well.
Well, where there's honey, the bees will come.
Yes, yeah.
And the flies.
If I may, Mr. Chair, where were you, you're putting together something, where were you planning on presenting that? Do you have any thoughts or ideas?
Well, I was going to, it's going to go on the website. I was thinking of doing something at Town Hall, but and I'll send it to you guys too, so you can put it on your website, right. And I'll print it out. But and I can email you the draft right now, so you
see. That'd be good, and we could put it on our CPC website. We've got all the projects listed, but I don't think we've ever done any kind of breakdown by category like that. So that would really be interesting.
And I've got it by the historical significance of each project as well, too. So
that's good.
You'll like it.
Excellent.
I learned a lot doing it. So
great. It all starts to tie together after a while, right?
And for the public out there, also, and if you know anyone, we are down a couple of members. Ed Desjardins retired after his incredible service to the community in lots of different ways, including the Historic Commission. And Joe Knapp is getting ready to retire as well. But I got two openings on our commission, and we'd love to. We're doing exciting projects. I know the schoolhouse, the cemetery. You know, the different parks and stuff, and lots of other historical aspects of town. We could use some help, and we have fun at our meeting. So thank you very much.
You
appreciate it, guys.
Thank you.
James,
thank you.
Thanks again.
Yep.
No, thank you.
So we'll move on to the Brocco Bank Museum paint and repair project. Chris, you'd like to walk us through this one?
Sure. My name's Chris Kaminsky, if you don't know. I'm the president of the Georgetown Historical Society, and we own and maintain the Brocco Bank Museum. And Jim, you had mentioned about where would we be without the CPA. Quite simply, the Brocco Bank would be closed if we didn't have that. We have depended heavily on it for the last several years for some major projects and appreciate all the money we get. I understand this year we're not getting quite what we asked for, but we're happy for anything you're willing to give us. Well, the historic Brocco Bank Museum was built in the late 1600s, and as any old home, it's very, very costly to maintain and to protect and to insure. What we take in each year in membership and donations just barely covers operating costs, particularly the exorbitant insurance. We last painted the museum in 2008. And since then, we've had some harsh winters, especially 2 years ago, really took its toll on the museum. And it's looking kind of unsightly now. You can see in that picture, there's a lot of paint peeling. We have some rotted areas. So we had requested $15,000 to repair the rot and to have it scraped. And there's the rotted area there, to have it scraped and primed and painted. I understand we got it approved for 12. So we'll have to do some fundraising to cover the difference, but we can manage. So short and sweet, I don't talk much. Does anyone have any questions on it or anything about Historical Society?
It's really impressive looking.
Well, it looks a lot nicer when the paint's not peeling.
Yeah, it looks nice.
That picture I think was taken shortly after we painted it last time. So it looks nice in that one. But it's not looking nice now. And the front, unfortunately, is the worst part. The part that everybody sees is the section that's peeling very badly now.
I'm trying to picture it as I drive by. Mm-hmm. Is that the schoolhouse in the back, or is the schoolhouse
No, the schoolhouse is on the other side.
That's what I thought, yeah. Okay.
And that, I'll put in two cents on that, too. The Historical Society gives tours of that. We give tours of the museum, and we include tours of the schoolhouse. And it is now at the point when I bring people in, I have to apologize. It looks that bad inside. The paint is all peeling and falling from the ceiling. And I have to say, you know, it's not up to us to maintain this. It's up to the town, and the town just, you know, doesn't always have the funding to do it. It is very embarrassing looking inside. And so, you know, I really hope that, you know, they're not getting it this year, but I sure hope next year we can find a way to come up with the funds to paint the inside and have it something we're not embarrassed about. This is town property. It's not used as a school anymore, but it's still used for educational purposes. And we shouldn't have a town property that looks embarrassing.
Is that one of three schoolhouses was around town at that period?
There were quite a few of them.
Okay.
But that is the last last one that hasn't been converted into a house or a garage or something like that. That was donated to the town. The town didn't really have any place to put it, so they contacted the Historical Society, and the society allowed them to put it on our property. So the town owns the schoolhouse, but does not own the property that the schoolhouse sits on.
Yeah, I remember when it was up in the field up in Muskie's place, mm-hmm. or Harry Levinsky's place.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
That's it. Any questions? Any other questions on it?
Just for the audience at home, when do you give the tours?
We're going to be opening June 25th this year, and we're open every Sunday 2 to 5 through Columbus Day. And we hope people will drop by. Members get in free, so if you want to join the Historical Society, by all means do. And if you live in a historic home, we do free house histories, too.
And if you get in on a good day, I'll be giving a tour.
Right,
of the schoolhouse. If you get there on a good day, I'll be giving a tour of the schoolhouse.
Well,
to help her out.
I just want to know, that's a historic tavern. I don't know why they're not selling liquor. That's what I want to know. I think it is.
We couldn't afford whatever extra licenses. We wouldn't be able to afford it. We run on kind of a shoestring budget.
Port is a little bit of historical recreation of what it must be like.
It would be
then.
Fun.
And we'll try not to shoot the sign over.
Some hard cider.
Some hard cider, and you can make some money on that. You get some restoration done there.
Yeah. And I'm happy to say that you know, a lot of people are confused about Historical Society and Historical Commission, and James mentioned about that. The Historical Society is a private nonprofit, and we're all volunteers. We have no paid staff. And the commission is a town board, but the two, we work fairly closely together. We try to keep in touch unfortunately, we're losing Ed, and Ed was our liaison between the two groups, but we try to keep in touch with who's doing what, so we know what each other is doing, and you know, this Historical Society assists the commission with research and things like that, so you know, we do work together.
Mm-hmm. So you lost Ed and you got me, okay?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's good.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay. Terrific.
Thank you
very much, Chris. All right, we're going to jump into the open space category projects. The next one is the West Street Fields Preservation. This is being put together by the Park and Rec.
Yes, this is. I'm going to discuss this project. This is project is sort of Dave Shower's project, but he's on the Park and Rec myself. We had actually worked on doing the restoration of the parking lot to expand the capacity, so people wouldn't have to park out on West Street during games, which is a big problem. And that was very successful. It got a lot of great feedback. The allocation of those monies was about $40,000 to do that, and left $11,000 in the fund because, you know, Dave doesn't like to spend money. So he basically, but at the same time, we also had this other project where the water department has changed their makeup a little bit, and there's some new processes out there for organic fertilizers, and there's some talk possibly about taking field number 3, which is the back field, the farthest one away from the water department, and possibly looking at possibly putting some fertilizer down in that area, some organic. We have a number of boards. We still have to go through the conservation. We still have to go through the commissioners of the water department. But we wanted to transfer that money into that fund. It's now in the West Street Fund, but leave it in the West Street Fund, reallocate it for the potential use of putting some fertilizer material. I say material because it's actually got a barley in it. It's a hops product on field number 3. If that is allowed by both the conservation and the water department, those fields are excellent because it can rain for 20 days, and you can play in those fields in 10 minutes. The problem is you can put your sprinkler systems on for 10 minutes, and 10 minutes later all that water's gone through. So we need to have some fertilization on those fields. We have none. When I say topsoil, we need to have some topsoil. We have none. But, you know, and we'd like to try to put up a base of at least, you know, an inch or two, whatever is the minimum recommended amount, so we can get green fields. People don't like the fields down there. They don't. Part of the reason they don't retain water when we turn the sprinkler systems on.
More of a compost than a fertilizer.
I'm using the word fertilizer because it's we're trying to fertilize the grass with. But it's a barley product, it's a hops product, it's a byproduct of, I think, the beer manufacturing, and they mix it with some other stuff. And I don't want to get into, because I know organic tea is what they use in Marblehead. They put them, there's a number of different composting methods and mixtures out there now, and everybody's, you know. So I can't speak to exactly what he's presenting,
yeah.
But it's all up for discussion. He's found a mix that he thinks is going to be, you know, really good and not going to harm anything in the area. So it may fly. The water department and the conservation may receive it positively, and or they may not. So, but I think we've had some preliminary discussions. It seems like it's very possible now. Just some history. I've been on the park 20 years, and the original commission, the water department, didn't want to touch those fields. Our original thought was, we're going to be off. That's the future, and we want you there temporarily. Well, the new commissioners seem to be a little bit more responsive to, you know, let's have some fields there that are decent, at least while the people are using them. Mm-hmm. And so the request is going to be to keep the money in that $11,000 that's left in that fund to keep it in that site to reallocate it to the potential use of a topsoil mix, I guess would be the terminology. And once again, I'm sorry that I thought David would be here to explain it all. But
no, that's great. Thank you, Jimmy. Right, so that would be, and that's, so this isn't any extra money. This is money that's already in there, already appropriated to the Park and Rec Commission, and it's money left over. So it's a good way to kind of repackage it and have the town vote on whether or not to redesignate it for this use. Any questions on that? Okay, we're up to the open space preservation category, and this is the Camp Dennison bathroom rehabilitation.
What do you think of that?
We've got somebody here who's ready to walk us through this project.
I thought we were historic.
No.
Actually, no.
No, because open space, Camp Dennison falls under the open space.
I wouldn't take it, Jim. Sorry.
Okay, yeah.
we can put it back if you want.
It doesn't matter. I was just curious. Hi, I'm Jim Lacey, chairman of the Camp Dennison Committee, that is the subcommittee of the Conservation Commission. We're presently working on a grant, as you can see, CPP-APP 096, to rehabilitate an existing bathroom facility at Camp Dennison. We are well underway, as I can show you as we get a little further into it. We're putting joint compounding wallboard at the moment. And we've looked at our costs going forward. And if you can pop to the next one. Yeah, that's the one.
Yeah.
We have about $13,000 worth of expenses that we've identified. And it's things like the lights, the money to put the lights in there, dryers and things like that. We've already paid for the sinks and the toilets and that sort of thing. And as it shows, we have about $3,000 left on the quote. That's the Gliona is the plumbing company that has done all of the plumbing for us. And what they have remaining is mostly just put the fixtures in. We need a hot water heater. We need to pay an electrician to put the lights in. And as you can see, we only have $18,000 left. And we have about $19,700. And we're asking for this money more as an insurance for us because, first of all, we do have, Camp Dennison has income. And a small amount of money right now we could cover. We are concerned about the possibility of things going wrong regarding the septic system. It was put in 2 or 3 years ago. We've never tied to it, and we have to do that. So there's some concerns about that. And also, we've told the CPC that our plan going forward is to self-fund capital projects so that we won't be coming back to the CPC. And at the moment, we have a quote. That's why I was surprised at $20,000, but it's cedar shingles. We have a quote for the lodge roof of $16,000. And that's an enormous roof. That building has got to be. Yeah, well, it's different kinds of shingles.
Oh, I understand.
Yeah. I mean, that building's got to be 70 feet long if it's an inch. So we've set aside money for that, some money. We can't even afford all of it right now. So basically, this $5,000 is kind of an insurance thing for us, that if it runs over, you know, we won't have to.
Yeah, you're saying it's insurance, but it's also you would have to stop projects if you don't have it. If money goes over, you just don't have anywhere to pay It's insurance, but I mean, it's a little bit more. It isn't like you can take out a loan. I mean,
oh no no no, it's got to
be there.
True.
If something goes wrong, right. You either stop the project stops till next year, or And our thought process with that is it's better to keep the project moving, and the money comes back next year, comes back. But it is a safety valve that you guys...
Right. And we might not need it. And we might not need it. It's a possibility that we don't need it.
Well, we
just don't know.
We didn't want to not give it to you and have you stop work for a year while we wait for a couple $1,000s. Because
And we appreciate it.
And that $18,000, Jim, that was CPA money as well, right?
Yes. Yes, that's that 096 number.
So we thought it'd be good. We wanted to protect our
investment. Yes, thank you.
Too,
yeah,
saying here's $5,000, you look like you need $1,500, but you know, we'll...
No. It's also you're in a position where you're making money.
We do have an income, which is why we've said that our plan is to self-fund our capital going forward.
You're generating business there, and you don't want to stop that because...
Right, that's right. Hopefully, we're planning on having it available. Oh, there's sort of a transition. This is the inside of the building with no walls, and the next one, I think, is just the walls up. The next one is the rough plumbing. One thing we decided to do, we didn't get into it, is to insulate it. The building was never insulated. And that's what we thought, you know, we'd hate to put the walls up and say, gee, you know, I wish we insulated it. So we did it. And that was kind of expensive. It cost about $1,500 to do that. And then we've put we have the showers in. There are two showers on each side, one handicapped and one standard. And that's where we are now. We're putting the joint compound on. And then we'll paint the walls with some kind of a very expensive epoxy paint and put the floor down and, you know, then put the fixtures in. So, you know, we're doing okay.
No plaster and horse hair?
No. I don't know what was in there originally. It's probably nothing. It's a very old building.
Is that blue board or green board or anything or just regular wall board?
I think it's green board, I'm pretty sure. I wasn't, I'm just...
There's a little bit of moisture over our camera.
Yeah, I'm just doing the joint compounding. I don't know about the wall board. No, other people do that.
Even the blue board would be a big improvement over just regular wall board.
Oh, yeah, I'm just about positive it has to be blue board because it's a bathroom. Bathroom. It's a commercial. Right. It's actually considered to be a commercial bathroom.
Yeah, I know.
Anyway, that's where we are. And I just want to tell everybody, Kim Tennyson's Easter egg hunt is on Saturday. If anybody has children, young children.
So what you're telling us is 10 years from now, when everybody is cross-country skiing down the rails trail, that bathroom will be open for use.
Yes, it's open.
So we can
the other bathroom is open in the summertime.
Because it has insulation, so you'll be able to cross-country ski down there.
You can take a shower.
Yeah, good. That's
what could be better than that.
Who would have thought you had that foresight to think about insulating now?
Yeah, so you can go in there in the winter. That's right.
The whole camp will be open. I'm back in 10 years when the rails trail there, and you can cross country ski to it.
Yeah,
terrific.
That's my thought.
We'll see.
You've done some great work down there.
It's good. I think people get a lot of satisfaction. It's like Paul. He gets a lot of satisfaction out of what he does, and.
It's a beautiful
There's a
spot.
Lot of satisfaction out of that.
So that's great.
Yeah, I know. It's a beautiful... I was down there a month ago at the Rock, just outside the boundary.
Oh.
Yeah, because that's kind of my swimming holes.
Oh, is that... Oh, when you were a kid. Yeah, yeah, on the other side of the stream there. Yeah.
Yeah,
that
ledge.
Yeah.
Yeah, we used to throw rocks at the kids from that camp. So that was
kind of the Brass Railroad.
Yeah.
Oh, I know. Yeah. No,
that's the other way, yeah. We used to cause trouble down there all the time as kids. There was always someone looking
When you were a kid, was it used?
Popovich lived right at the end of they had that big house, all the Popovich kids. It must have been 15 of them. So we used to go down there, and that was their place to get in trouble.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Appreciate the information. So that's the that's completes our review of the projects that we're recommending for 2017. We'd like to thank you on behalf of the Community Preservation. Thank you for watching the presentation. And please go to town meeting on Monday, May 1st, and vote on these projects. And there's more information on our website, www.georgetowncpc.com. Is there any other business to come before the Community Preservation Committee, or any questions? I want to thank everyone for coming out today and for the information that you provided on the projects and your questions. And I hope the folks at home who are tuning in
got some good information on the projects that we're proposing for this year. So with that, if there's a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
So moved.
Okay. That's it. We're adjourned. Thank you very much.